Penguin Random House Audio presents Let Them See You, The Guide for Leveraging Your Diversity at Work by Porter Braswell with Ryan Galloway. This is the author, Porter Braswell. Prologue. I'm Porter Braswell, the CEO and co-founder of a company called Jopwell, a technology platform that helps Black, Latinx, and Native American students and professionals unlock opportunities for career advancement. Under my leadership, Jopwell has formed partnerships with more than 100 of America's leading companies and has facilitated tens of thousands of connections between the Jopwell community members and our clients. To date, we've raised more than $11.5 million from the likes of Magic Johnson, Andreessen Horowitz, Y Combinator, K4 Capital, Q-Ball, and others. Since we founded Jopwell in 2015, the company has been recognized by Entrepreneur Magazine, 100 Most Brilliant Ideas, Fast Company, World's Most Innovative Companies, and Business Insider, one of the hottest New York City companies to watch. Over the years, I've received professional awards and recognition that include being named to LinkedIn's Next Wave Top Professionals 35 and Under, Inc. Magazine's 30 Under 30, Fast Company's 100 Most Creative People in Business, Crain's 40 Under 40, Vanity Fair's Future Innovators Index, and Adweek's Young Influencers, the publication's annual list of the most innovative minds under age 40. Before Jopwell, I worked at Goldman Sachs, buying and selling currencies. Before Goldman Sachs, I attended Yale University, where I was a member of the men's varsity basketball team. Working at Goldman Sachs was everything my family had envisioned for me. My father, born in the Bronx with very few resources, became general counsel for a publicly traded utility company and, eventually, a New Jersey state judge. My mother, raised in the suburbs of New York in Westchester County, was an elementary school teacher in the inner city of East Orange, New Jersey. My parents worked so hard to give me access to a great education, and working in the financial industry was their dream for me. But it wasn't my dream. Grateful as I was to them, I wanted more. In spite of my education, there are many factors that should have led to the failure of Jopwell by now. One, I'm a Black male, which means I belong to a group that gets less than 1% of venture capital money, despite African Americans making up 11% of the U.S. population. Additionally, all Black founding teams raise almost half as much money compared to all white founding teams. Two, I'm non-technical, and so is my co-founder, Ryan. Tech companies that don't have a technical founder are almost always destined for failure. Three, I had never started a business before. Four, I was only 27 when we launched Jopwell. Five, I quit an incredibly desirable job, and so did my partner. Giving up and going back to finance would have been much easier. I've written this book because I want to significantly expand the conversation about diversity in the workplace. I believe in the power of technology to change this issue, though I know that there are no easy answers. We've all seen headlines like these. Forbes, Apple CEO Tim Cook is not satisfied with employee diversity. The Guardian, why are innovative tech companies still struggling with diversity? TechCrunch, it's true. Black female founders receive basically zero venture capital. I know that many companies are hungry to hire diverse candidates and that the lack of diversity is a problem they care about and feel responsibility for changing. Diversity is also good for business, but our national conversation about this subject is stuck in a rut. To start to change that, I'm going to share the success stories of others as well as my own. This audio program will bring you face-to-face with real-world strategies for overcoming common obstacles for people of color. And it will also teach you the lessons that I've learned from some of my influential mentors, including people such as Magic Johnson, NBA legend and NBA Hall of Fame inductee, and Mitch and Frida Kapoor, VC investors and activists in the field of organizational culture and diversity. When we first started Jopwell, we intentionally decided not to refer to our community as diverse. We felt this diluted our mission, and instead, we decided to refer to our community as Black, Latinx, and Native American. Even with this specification, we understood that racial and cultural identity is complicated, varied, and personal. We used the word Black to capture the many and very different cultures that fit underneath the umbrella term. In the same vein, we use the term Latinx so we can be as inclusive as possible to all identities in that spectrum. We believe that in America, being Black creates shared experiences for all those who identify as such. At the start of 2017, we changed from using Latino to Latinx as we wanted to be gender neutral and more progressive in the way we discussed our population. Throughout this program, I've used the term people of color, or POC, because in corporate America, the most underrepresented groups are POC. While POC is an umbrella term that doesn't allow us to discuss the nuances of each unique culture, it does allow for a dialogue detailing practical advice that minorities can implement and leverage in the workplace to realize their potential. As a Black American male, I, too, would rather not be categorized under such large umbrella terms. But for the purpose of this audio program, and in order to provide the most practical advice to the largest audience that historically hasn't been seen in the workplace, I use the term POC. The practical advice presented throughout this audio program is meant to help you overcome challenges and obstacles that arise while working with naive and sheltered colleagues, not racist colleagues. Racism still exists in all locations. If you don't believe me, read my LinkedIn post on what happened to me on my subway ride home in New York City. LinkedIn.com/pulse/things-still-happen-porter-braswell. It's important to call this out now because, again, as a Black man, I have experienced racism and also dealt with ill-informed and yet not intentionally malicious colleagues. It's important to know the difference. You have to find a way to thrive in environments where your peers just don't seem to get it. It will make you a stronger person, a better leader, and a more effective mentor. In environments where you are dealing with racism, you have to speak up and speak out against it. The challenge is being able to identify what's ignorance and what's racism, which I trust you'll be able to do as I have and still do. The advice in this audio program will also assist in that process. We're each born with an internal compass that directs us to what we're meant to do. We all want a purpose. Some people recognize that purpose as a calling, a deep sense of responsibility, or an unsettling feeling that makes them scared they're not living up to their potential. Whatever you name it, that thing is something we all have and feel. When we are able to follow that compass, movements are created, businesses are built and re-engineered, corporate ladders are climbed, and leaders emerge. Introduction. Like many women of color who choose to wear their hair naturally, Chelsea Johnson often encounters uninvited criticism from her colleagues and peers about her hair. They've called it wild, unprofessional, masculine, and even just ugly. In response, she's done what many professionals of color often do when faced with insensitivity in the workplace. She's taken a deep breath and done her best to educate her coworkers. Chelsea's hardly alone. People of color in the workforce are reminded daily that we're different from most of our coworkers. The vast majority of those reminders are unintentional, and the speakers rarely intend to be insensitive. Often, they're cloaked in positivity. I'd need a few dozen hands to count the number of times I've been told how articulate or well-spoken I am. But even though the speaker thought they were paying me a compliment, I felt as if they'd assumed I wouldn't be articulate, which is alarming. Every time it happened, it chipped a little piece of me away. It made me a little less engaged at work. It made me a little less likely to go above and beyond. And it kept me from referring diverse.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.